I joined because I wanted to be white. And I saw that badge as a symbol of, I'm one of you, I'm not one of them. I ignored some of the racism. I perpetrated some of it. I had to hurt people to get here. There were scenarios and people and experiences that I couldn't go back and apologize to. So how do I reconcile that within myself? How do I forgive myself?
I'm lost.
I remember coming home from school and sitting on the sofa was a huge black man. You know, to me as a kid, little kid, he was a giant. This was the first time I had physically seen a black person who wasn't on the TV. And I was terrified. And I remember sitting there looking at him. And my suitcase was next to him on the sofa. And when I came in, my foster mother said, "This is your father." And I remember looking at her and then looking at him. And I'm thinking, "You're my mommy and daddy. I don't know who this man is."
This is Toyin. She's Nigerian. Why she's here and what sort of problems beset foster parents who try to bring up colored children, I've come here to find out.
In the early 60s, up until the early 80s, there was a thing in African communities called farming. It was almost like, yeah, I'll have children, but I'm still working on my career, so the kids are going to stay with such and such.
Are you registered foster parents?
Yes.
So as far as you're concerned, you'd take any baby into the home, whether race, colour, creed, wouldn't worry you at all?
Oh, no, any child that was in need.
When I look at this picture, I see a mixture of joy and sadness. The joy because I did love my foster mother. The sadness because it also was representative of how a lot of filters were implanted in me. In that picture, there's an unlimited future. Little did he know that was going to come his way. Like my foster mother used to say things to me like, "If it wasn't for us, you know, be running around with a bone through your nose." Or, "Careful, don't send him down to the coal shed because we'll never find him again." Right? So there were jokes about my colour. Without consciously being aware of it, I was being given my place in society. I was with my foster parents until I was about 7 or 8. And then my foster mother told me, "Your father, he's going to take you to London for a couple of weeks." London meant nothing to me. And throughout the whole journey, my father didn't say one word to me. I came from a practically all-white environment, and then suddenly I've gone from that into a totally black environment where I didn't understand the dynamics of the blackness. The food had changed. The language had changed. Suddenly I'm being forced to embrace this religion, and it just didn't fit in with my view of the world. Growing up in Kent, we knew the local bobby. I had no concept or awareness of race. And then I come to my dad's house, and there were conversations in the living room about the police. And I'm sitting there listening to us thinking, I have no idea. I was brought up that the police were your friends. Until one day, I think I was about 8 or 9, and I'm walking to school with my white Irish friend. There was a police officer, and my white friend goes running up to him and says, "Hello, Mr. Policeman." Starts talking to him, and then he puts his hand in his pocket and he gives him a coin. And I thought, ooh, the police are giving away money. So I go running up and I said to this police officer, I said, "Hello, Mr. Policeman." And he looked at me and he said, fuck off, you little black bastard. And I remember being hit by those words. That was the moment I realized I was black. From that moment, I hated police.
This carnival has been in Notting Hill for 10 years. But this year, even before it began, there were problems.
Every year we had the Notting Hill Carnival. On the rare occasions I was allowed to go, I was one of the ones who were throwing rocks and bricks at the police. How I never got arrested, I don't know. We were going to the mosque in London for Eid, and there were hundreds of people walking down the road. And in the middle of this junction was a black police officer directing traffic. And I remember him standing in the middle of the road and he went like that. And all the cars stopped. And I was just like, wow. And I stood there just looking at him. It was the first time I had seen a black person in a position of power. And then you'd go like that and the cars moved. And I said to my dad, that's what I want to do. And my dad turned around, looked at me, said, they will kill you. And he slapped me around the face. But a seed was planted in that moment.
It was a time of huge tensions over racial matters.
No matter what you say or do, some people still be prejudiced, you know, no matter what law they're bringing.
Every bad thing that happened to me had happened when I was in a black space. It wasn't about the black community. It was about my survival. My mindset was to behave and become as white as possible because white people don't suffer. I applied 5 times. Over 3.5 years. 4 times I was rejected. I went to the police training college. Initially on the first day I was proud. That very quickly was knocked out of me.
London's next generation of police officers.
In our intake, there was about 90 odd. And in that 90 odd, 4 of us were from a minority background. First of all, when you went there, you were scared to talk to the other black guys. People saw you sitting together. People were looking, why are you lot sitting together? So initially I avoided them. I made eye contact, but it was like, that was about it. It was those subtle microaggressions, those subtle comments. I remember one of the instructors used to come up and say, Smiley, Smiley, come on, smile so we can see you. There were constant reminders that I was black. I went to see one of the instructors. I literally poured my heart out. And his response to me was, you know what your problem is, son? You have a chip on your shoulder. And it was just like, wow. What do I need to do to fit in here? And then the universe provides an opportunity. And I was in my room one evening, and there's a knock at my door. And they said, we think you're
the wrong colour for the job.
And I had some of this shoe whitener that we used to whiten our trainers with. And they painted me white. And they said, now you fit in. If you asked any of those guys now, they'd probably say, well, you know, he allowed us to do it to him. And I say, yeah, I did. I would say, yes, I did. Because that's what I felt I needed to do to be happy. People look at it and they're sort of like, that's shocking. But the part of that story is that I laughed along with them. I saw that as, finally, I have my breakthrough moment. That's how I saw it. That's how I saw myself.
Progress is entirely on merit. And in an expanding service, there is plenty of room for people with ambition and ability. The police service draws all its leaders from within its own ranks. And the young man or woman who shows exceptional promise in the early years may be eligible for the special course at Bramshill Police College.
As a young probationer, you were expected to get X number of stops and searches. So I would go out and look for that number of stops and searches. All I was thinking about is, am I doing the work I need to do to go to the next stage of my development? I didn't stop to think, am I targeting every black person?
Young West Indians are 50% more likely to be stopped and bullied than any other group.
But the police have abused the powers that they've been given.
9 out of 10 of the people who are stopped have committed no offence whatever.
My initial ideas with policing was, how do I suppress you? How do I keep you in check? If you take the old adage, you have to work twice as hard to be half as good. So I would have to go out and do more stop and searches than other officers did to prove I was not one of those people they were looking at on the street. If you did 5, I would have to do 10. Because that's the only way I'm going to convince you I'm not like them. That power to conform says, okay, what am I going to do here to make sure you see me as part of you? And the way I would do that is I would make fun of me. If I tell you racist jokes, you won't notice I'm black. I say things like, I can't eat Kit Kats. And they say, why not? I say, because I keep biting my fingers. In the beginning, I was part of the joke. And then it gets to a point where you start, hang on, this is going a bit... Something about this is not right. Doesn't feel right. You and I both know we're talking about them. You're not talking about me. And then there's a point where you suddenly think, oh shit, you are talking about me. So I make it more of an effort to make it about the other. There were racist jokes, there were homophobic jokes.
Out on the streets, there are ample signs that even fear of the disease has not put a stop to the promiscuous lifestyle enjoyed by many homosexuals.
They are arresting large numbers of gay men for alleged sexual offences.
There are certain sections of the community who consider that homosexuals should not be.
The attacks on gay men are continuing. Their anger could lead them to protect themselves.
In my private life, I was hiding my sexual orientation. I was dealing with those questions of people saying, why aren't you married yet? I had pictures in my wallet of a wife and child. I didn't know who they were, but I would say that they're my ex-wife. Or as I called her, the bitch, right, who had taken my kid and gone to America and separated. It was going about adding another brick or another layer of defense to that facade. The days when I was used for every recruitment campaign and publicity shot and everything that I remember that day well. This was about asking people to dump their knives and not stabbing people. So they asked me if I could come in and just hold the knife and be in the picture. If there was a politician who came to the station, I would be the one to walk with them down the high road. If there was a celebrity that came to the station, I'd be wheeled out to stand with them. If there was a recruitment campaign, I was on the paper. And it was almost like, yeah, you're good, you're not a troublemaker, so we'll use you for good things. for me, I was that kind of guy, oh, I love the limelight, you know. And I was happy to do it because I thought they liked me, you know. But all that comes at a cost because then, you know, in some ways, there's something about it that made me feel like I was a performing monkey.
From almost day one, these five gang members were the chief suspects.
The murder of black teenager Stephen Lawrence triggered the biggest investigation of racial attitudes in nearly two decades.
McPherson report held up by his family as hope for change.
Of course, he's already seen the leaks. The report will say he heads a racist police force, criticises his personal handling of the Lawrence affair, and hints he's got what amounts to an attitude problem. It's a stinging attack.
I was selected to join this positive action team, which dealt with the recruitment, retention and development of minority groups within the police. That was its role.
Today, there's a desperate rush to catch up. Their entire credibility is at stake in the wake of the Lawrence inquiry.
This is the police, you know, like, I'm sceptical of the police.
Why?
It's bad publicity.
Ask as many questions as you like. It's not a secret organisation. No secret society. We're open. See it for yourself. Make your own mind up.
Initially, it was a great department to work in. It turned into a very toxic environment. One day, there was an inspector that worked there, and he walked in and he said, oh, a black ass. I love a black ass. And he grabbed me and started trying to dry hump me. And I just stood up like, and he walked out laughing. And I was just in this total shock. And then I reported it. And then I was summoned to see the officer who was put in charge of the investigation. And what he said was, at the end of the day, G, do you really think this is going to go anywhere? And I looked at him and I thought, you're the man who's supposed to be investigating this, and that's your starting point? And I just stood up and I walked out. And I went home that Friday. And I spent the whole weekend walking around in circles. My head was just like, I don't know where to go now. Everything's falling around me. Everything's going wrong. My whole life was just collapsing in on itself. It was almost like that same moment when the officer said to me, fuck off, you black bastard. My self-worth was being dismissed. It was almost like everything that had happened in between had been a waste of time. And then it got to Sunday night, and I sat down and I wrote a suicide note. And I put it on the coffee table, and I went to the local train station, and then suddenly, it was bizarre, I just went blank. It was almost like I blinked, and then when I opened my eyes, I'm sitting at my desk at work. And what woke me up, there was a woman who worked there. And I just looked at her and I just burst into tears. I remember she said to me, she goes, you're the first one of us they broke. She goes, you don't need to be here. You need to get out of here now. And I went to the doctors and I was signed off work. And basically I'd had a breakdown. Everything I believed about myself, everything I thought about myself had come crashing down. And I was in this space of, I don't know who the hell I am anymore. I was appointed a counsellor who eventually I agreed to see. The first question he asked me was, who defines you? Who defines you? And that was a question that confused the hell out of me. It made me realise I was trying to be what I thought other people wanted me to be. Looking back on my childhood, and I could see this whole line of me always being lost. And then I thought, the only person who hasn't told me who I am is me. I had all these things, not only about the black experience, but the gay experience, you know, belonging to a community that would openly be homophobic. And I'll never forget it, it was a weekend. And this particular weekend, for some reason, I'd been thinking about all of this stuff. It was really like, right? And it felt almost like you're a caterpillar in this cocoon and you're trying to break out. This just doesn't fit. There wasn't a plan. And I walked into the office on Monday morning and there was this female sergeant. And she comes in and she's in a bit of a huff. And I turned to her, I said, are you okay? She goes, oh God, she goes, men. She goes, I can't stand there. I said, what do you mean? She goes, oh, my boyfriend. And she goes into what he had done that weekend and how he had pissed her off and all this sort of stuff, right? And then she says, I suppose you don't have this problem with all the women you've got on the go. And I remember sitting at my desk and I looked up. I said, actually, I'm gay. And I just stood up and I walked out the office. And I remember walking out the corridor and I was thinking, what did I just do? What did I just say? And then I stopped and I met another colleague who was coming up the stairs. And he said, hey, G, how's it going? I said, fine. I said, by the way, I've just come out the closet. And he goes, you what? And I said, I've just come out the closet. He goes, good on you. And I walked up and I thought, ooh. And I just went round telling everybody.
It's taken me 40 years, but I'm here. 40 years of hiding, and I've come out.
It was the first time, I think, in my life where I had actually owned me. This was 100% me. I was going on that stage to be me.
As I stand here, I feel proud to be here, proud to stand in front of all of you, proud to say that I'm black, I'm gay, but more importantly, I'm a human being.
What people connect with is that journey to find yourself. My race, my sexual orientation, my gender, they belong to me. You have as much impact on them as I allow you to have. You're going out there as police officers. How you treat them will have an impact on how they see the police. I teach, I use my story, my dynamics, to help people to understand how our stories shape us. I've retired from the police, but I still go back into police forces and still talk about it, using my story as an example. And it's something I want to do for as long as I can. If I have done something or said something or given something that will help make you more comfortable with you, that's the biggest joy of my life.